since 1989, a long time. And when asked to give this presentation, I actually had, you know, it's one of those horrible moments. I had absolutely no idea what I was going to talk about. So I decided to take the approach that Mary's taken and actually try and remember what I actually went through when I started my PhD many moons ago. And it was one of those weird things, you know, you can't remember what it was like. It's a bit like saying, with your mobile phone, what did we do before mobile phones? How did we talk to people? How do we do it? How do we organise anything in our lives before the mobile phone? You can't actually remember how that was. But in fact, that was quite recent. So let me start where I started, and that was at the tender age of 22 in the Gambia in West Africa, 200 miles upriver in a place called Farafeni. I'd only ever been to the Isle of Wight off the south coast of England before going, so it was a bit of a shock. But it had several characteristics with respect to accessing information. At Farafeni, which was a research centre for malaria, we had a radio which could communicate with Fajara. The telephone number for this unit that you see here was Farafeni 2. In order to actually make that connection, we had to send someone across the river to Mansa Congo to wake up the man in the telephone exchange who would plug the line in. So therefore, we had a radio, and the radio was the only means I had of communicating with anybody on the coast who had any possible access to medical literature. And if they ever travelled upriver, they would bring their personal copies of Transactions of the Royal Society of Tropical Medicine and show me. I would then go through it eagerly that night and say, please give me a copy of this one, please give me a copy of this one. I'll give them a list. When they went back to Fajara, they'd do a photocopy for me, and I'd cherish that. So after 5 years, I had a pile of photocopies of absolute gems of papers that I thought I would have for the rest of my life, and that pile would grow with my career. So that was basically how I accessed information in 1984. I finished my PhD on the clinical trials. The first clinical trials on insecticide-treated bed nets were done in the Gambia as part of my PhD. And then in 1989, I moved to Kilifi District Hospital, which you see there. I notice actually Professor Kabiru's here. Salam Kazi. Very good. Anyway, this was what he and I will remember as our unit in Kilifi District Hospital, and things actually weren't that much better in terms of getting access to information. Being attached to the University of Oxford, they did fax us every now and then the front sheet of the Lancet or New England Journal of Medicine so that we could see what might be of interest to us, which we would then fax back and they would send by DHL. Alternatively, during leave, I would have a massive list of things. I would go to the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine Library and spend, to be honest, actually quite enjoyable times ploughing through all the hardback journals and taking them to the photocopying machine with my card, photocopying everything I could possibly photocopy, realising your card's run out in the middle. Have you ever done that? You run out in the middle of sort of the sort of photocopying your papers. You have to run back and load it up with more 10p's. Run back, and that was it. And then I'd be weighted down coming back to Kenya with photocopies of papers. That was access to medical literature between 1989 and about 1994. And this is when I moved to set up the Malaria Public Health and Epidemiology Group here in Nairobi, still part of the University of Oxford KEMRI collaboration. And things were beginning to improve. Obviously, we didn't have to rely entirely on the fax machine. We did have email just about coming in around about then. But in fact, access to medical literature was still difficult in 2000. And I was responsible for leading the team to develop the National Malaria Strategy for Kenya, for the Kenyan government. And basically, what the ambition was that this would be evidence-based. We wouldn't just choose any old strategy. We would use the medical literature that had proven efficacies on defined interventions so that our strategy for the country would be scientifically driven. But of course, most of the people working in the Ministry of Health didn't have access to the original material. And there were, I don't know if anyone was party to some of those discussions, there were absolute firm advocates that clearing bushes around people's houses was the way to control malaria. And in fact, they said that has to be a major chapter in the National Malaria Strategy. Of course, there is no scientific evidence to prove or disprove that. But it's very hard to quickly, as Matt was saying earlier, quickly go online and demonstrate to somebody that, in fact, this is not supported by any scientific evidence. But insecticide-treated bed nets and indoor residual spraying is, and this is the evidence. And I think in 2000, that was particularly hard to do. And finally, in 2005, I established the Malaria Atlas Project, which I'll come to a bit later, which has its own unique features about accessing material and ultimately disseminating material to the wider malaria community. Now, of course, things have changed, and as Matt was saying, this was the unit in Kilifi in 1989. This is now the Kenya Medical Research Institute in 2004-05, largely thanks to Wellcome Trust funding, but also many other donors. So we've gone from that to that. Of course, in between is when I came to Nairobi, so I don't quite enjoy this environment. But there have been lots of other changes. The internet, for example. I mean, we can't imagine lives now, can we not, without the internet. PDF libraries. We shouldn't underestimate the sort of Adobe Acrobat. I mean, it wasn't so long ago that we didn't have such a facility, software facility, to actually condense and digitize published materials. And it can be linked to EndNote. I mean, EndNote is just one reference library software, but, you know, fabulous resources that we've got at our disposal now. PubMed Online. In fact, I don't use EndNote anymore. I just use PubMed. So if I need to search for something, I will use PubMed directly. Hinari, no one's mentioned that so far, but in fact this was a major revolution for many of us in Africa to be able to access material through this WHO and others funded initiative, which provided PDF libraries for people to get hold of. And finally, the whole sort of movement of open access, which we'd have to say is still relatively new in the sort of grander scheme of things. So why did it take such a really good idea like open access so long to come about? And I'll quickly run through these because Matt's already touched on most of it. But basically, the history, the tradition has been biomedical research results are privately owned and sold to only those who can afford it. This is what we keep talking about, the traditional model. Publishers make huge profits by restricting access. So there are some big publishing houses out there, and they make a huge amount of money out of taking copyright off of you as somebody who's given them your research. Medical research results, they should be considered a global public good, but the big journals don't do that. And if you ever get an opportunity to hear Gavin Yammy, who is the opposition, I realise that, but he's not anymore because he's left PLOS Medicine. But if you hear him give a talk, he basically says the following. You write a research paper. This is the traditional model. You give it to the publishers, and you hand over to them copyright. And then they sell it to people who can afford to buy that. Now, if you did a big drug trial, so for example, if we did a trial, which we have done, on chlorpromazine dapsone, then we published that in The Lancet. They probably made over £1 million in returns on sales for that article. And I didn't realise this till Gavin told me, it's a £5 billion a year industry, the whole copyright thing, and only a fraction of the tiny fraction of the intended audience actually reads your work. And there's only four big companies in the game of making money out of your research. In fact, Gavin would give it with a bit more passion than I've done, but I think you're getting the sense that it's a model that had to change. And one of the sort of catalysts for change was Sir Mark Warport, who is the director of the Wellcome Trust, and he saw and heard on the news, actually, I think it was on ITN or something, he heard that there was a big Wellcome Trust-funded vaccine trial just released in The Lancet, and fabulously encouraging results for Africa and the future of malaria control. So he goes online to see if he can find it, and of course, access denied. Well, it's funded by the Wellcome Trust. Duh. Well, in fact, Sir Mark probably wouldn't have said duh. But, you know, there is a sense there that here we are, the largest funder of medical research in the UK, funds a piece of work in Africa on a malaria vaccine. He can't get access to the published work. 2006, the Wellcome Trust decided that, in fact, anything that they fund from now on has to be in the public domain. So you have to actively encourage publishing on open access journals or submitting, as somebody said recently, your sort of final manuscript within 6 months of your research being published in a journal. It has to be put in UK PubMed Central. A couple of examples here. This was a really important paper for someone, and they were out in the sticks somewhere in Tanzania, I think it was, and they needed to find this paper quickly, but they had to pay $30 actually to read it, and it's about cesarean section and unexplained stillbirth in the developing world. But they had to pay $30. Kind of a scandal, really, isn't it? This one actually made me laugh. Impediments to promoting access to global knowledge in sub-Saharan Africa. You have to pay $25 to actually find out what this guy says. Now, the solution, obviously, is the obvious, and it's what we're here to talk about today. It's just make all research results freely available online. It's really kind of an obvious thing. And this guy, who's the Nobel laureate and PLOS co-founder, Harold Varmus, who was also very interested in malaria at the time that he became an evangelical about open access. He was interested in a multilateral initiative in malaria. He says that this is an absolute must for the scientific community, and how could we not do it? And he was sort of one of the originators of the open access movement. So what do we mean? We've already been through this. It's free, unrestricted online access. You own the copyright, but we're under this Creative Commons attribution license. And you can send it anywhere. You can send it to absolutely everybody, from your mum, your mum's friend at the tennis club. You can send it anywhere, to a journalist in the Daily Mail, or even the journalist in the Daily Nation. And I will come back to that in a moment, because this is what is being encouraged currently, but has an upside and a downside. The author retains the copyright, and you basically put in a public repository. Now, this isn't new for some people. I notice physicists here have been doing this for years. They don't bother about publishing in peer-reviewed journals. They put a lot of stuff that they do, including mathematicians, online straight away. In fact, it's actually self-regulated, their whole work, and people trying to prove a straight line will be constant communication online about new findings. But if you look actually at the progress by which things have evolved over the last 10 years, we've got now an absolute, for me anyway, in malaria, these are the big ones, the sort of PLOS Medicine, Malaria Journal, PLOS Biology, Parasites and Vectors. But there is a whole raft of journals that I really do want to access that aren't open access. Lancet, New England Journal, Trends in Parasitology, Transactions, Annals, American Journal of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene, and many of the African health journals. That really drives me nuts. And it's really hard even to find the hard copies in the Kemri Library. And, to get any copy of the East African Medical Journal, I have to go to the journal office. In fact, the last time I went there, they didn't have their latest issue. So it's almost virtually physically impossible to get access to some of the really good work, that, like, for example, Mary was talking about, that is published in African journals by African scientists. I think that really does have to change. A couple of things that are still not perfect. Well, some of them, as a scientist, and I accept all the points that Mary's made, but quite frankly, for me, I have to publish in the highest impact factor journals. And an impact factor journal will be a journal that will actually self-promote itself and has an impact factor. Now, I'm not saying that the impact factor thing is right. It's probably wrong for science. Nevertheless, if I publish in The Lancet, I get an impact factor immediately, depending on how many times, irrespective of how many times it's cited, of 16. If I publish in Nature, it'll be something like 35. If I publish in Tropical Medicine and International Health, it'll be 1.2. Now, my career and my future funding is judged on my cumulative impact factor. And people say to you, no, it's not. It's on the impact you make in the public health world. And all that. It's nonsense. People who actually review your CV will run it through the grill to see how you stack up against other scientists. And the Wellcome Trust still do that, actually, although they say that they're interested in translating research into practice In fact, they will still look at your impact factor. They are still mightily impressed if you've published in the New England Journal of Medicine. They are still less impressed if you published in the Malaria Journal. So something has to change there in terms of what our careers are judged on in terms of impact factors if we are to kill this whole sort of mafia of journals who insist upon making people pay. I also think that there's a huge amount of old literature out there that needs to be archived and we need to access. I think some of the best papers in malaria were published before even sort of the 1960s. You know, they're in the 1930s, 1940s. Some of them are a bit indigestible because they're sort of massive tomes, but they are fabulous pieces of work that we're not able to access. And we don't access. We only access the thing that we read yesterday that was published yesterday. We are, as we said, still dependent on internet speeds. I mean, when we're all at our program, there's 60 of us in Nairobi working on malaria public health. If we're all accessing the internet at the same time trying to download something, it slows right down. I mean, bandwidth is still a problem, and that still perpetuates a north-south divide. The other thing is that at the moment, there is just simply too much to read. I'd have to say that. It is just absolutely impossible to stay up with now this growth of journals and growth of literature. And I'll show an example of this in a minute. There are search engines available, so they can actually pull off all the literature for you and give you everything on malaria once a week. But what that means, of course, is that I don't read the journal. So I don't read through the transactions anymore and say, well, but that's interesting. I know that's on cholera in sort of Djibouti, but actually let me just have a little dip into that. I don't do that anymore. I just get right to sort of my search engine's listing of what I should be reading. I sort of highlight those, give those to somebody, and they download the PDFs for me, and I only read that. I think my reading now has become far more restricted because there is so much more information out there. And I'll add this because I think it's important. I also question whether the quality has improved with the sort of the growth in the volume. This is the number of malaria, since I started, since we started in 1984, all the way through to 2009, this is the number of papers published each year on malaria. And it's been an exponential growth. I haven't got a metric of how good they are, but I do know, because I review quite a bit, that there is an absolute dross out there. I mean, I've refused to review now for PLOS One. PLOS One is a journal which is entirely open access, and they will publish anything. So, Mary, there are a number of journals where you can be absolutely guaranteed if you submit something, it will be published. In fact, that is the mantra of the Malaria Journal. And I am a great advocate for the Malaria Journal. I think Marcel Hommel, who is the editor, has done a fabulous job. And I'm a great supporter of it. It's increased sort of openness to many, many authors who wouldn't have had the opportunity to publish before. But nothing, almost nothing, will get rejected. And the consequence of that, of course, is that there are some stuff out there that is of dubious quality. And I put this one on here because with the more information out there that's readily accessible, very quick to get, journalists pick up on things very quickly. And there's some absolute nonsense out there. One of the best examples, which was reviewed recently in Nature, is the whole climate gate fiasco, where there's a lot of stuff out there that is of very, very poor quality that's being published around climate change and health that can get into any sort of journal just like that, just because of its topic. If it was in PLOS One, it would definitely get published. You wouldn't have to, you know, people spend hours reviewing. You know what it's like reviewing manuscripts, and then you find, having sort of like pulled it apart, you find it online the following week. Journalists pick up on all the material. Irrespective, they presume because it's in a scientific journal, it's credible. So I think we're losing something a little bit in the peer review process. And I know speed is important for the open access movement, but we should not lose sight of quality. Now I'll just move on to the one step beyond. And I think that there is another step, and that's open access data. The Internet Rights Charter says scientific and social research that is produced with the support of public funds should be freely available to all. Now, I would argue that that also includes the data that goes with the publicly funded research. So it's not just your paper that should be available to the public. It should also be the data that has been used to generate that paper, and I'll explain a little bit. This is now new territory. It's uncomfortable territory for many scientists, actually, to think about releasing their data to somebody else, but they have, after all, released the paper. And I want to use as an example something that we've set up, which is the Malaria Atlas Project. And it has three steps, really. First of all is harvesting as much information as is possible since the 1980s on malaria parasite prevalence. And parasite prevalence is if you go into a village and you bleed 100 children, how many of them have malaria parasites in their blood? And that's a really good indicator of transmission intensity, which can then guide on what sorts of interventions you should be putting in place and how much immunity that population has. So there's millions and millions of surveys that have been done all over the world, but they're often hard to access because they're either compressed into one estimate for a whole region instead of individual villages, or they're just not simply available. And one example is the sort of government Ministry of Health data, some of which is of very high quality going back to the 1980s when the Division of Vector-Borne Diseases used to do school surveys in Kenya. And these data need to be harvested, cleaned, archived, curated, and stored. So that's the first part of MAP. The next bit I won't bore you with, but this is the thing that sort of gets us out of bed in the morning, and this is the space-time modelling of that data, because it's uneven in space and uneven in time. So we use basic geographer's principles of geospatial statistics to try and predict between points where you don't have information actually an estimate of prevalence. And then the third thing is what we want to do is now we've done all of that, shouldn't we just put it back out there for other people to use? This is a bit, I don't know if you can see this. This is the data that we had in 2000 for the 2007 iteration of the map, about 8,000 data points. Each of them have been geocoded. We've got a longitude and latitude. You can see it all on Google Earth. But when we published this, many other people said, well, hang on a minute, that's really cool. We've got data. Why don't you use these data? And now it's been sort of opened the floodgate, really, of people saying, well, look, there's a lot of unpublished material that we do have. We're not going to use it again. Why don't you have it? This is what it now looks like. So we've gone from that to that. I like doing that, actually. It's good, isn't it? Anyway, that's now the data. We have 22,000 data points in the space of a year and a half after publishing the first one in PLOS Medicine. So there's been a massive increase in the amount of information that we have to run these time-space models, which gives us far more precise estimates of a prediction temporally and spatially. And this is basically some of the work that we're doing to make a map of risk at a global level, which is the first time it's been done since the 1950s. But, as I said, no one else can do that experiment that we've done because they haven't got the data. And it's not, so public health data is completely different from laboratory data. If you work in the lab, you publish your methods with the reagents. So someone sitting in Australia, so long as they got access to the reagents, can repeat your experiment to see if it actually works in their lab. For public health data, we can't do that. So you think all these big papers that are published on infant and child mortality, you would have to have access to the raw data to repeat that experiment. And I don't think we're doing enough in public health to make data available. So what we want to do is set up a repository, excuse the pun, but actually it worked well because the Wellcome Trust funded it, is a repository of open access data, the Malaria Atlas Project, roadmap. It's basically put the data back out there online. And we would like to provide the original source material so people can check back, which would mean putting on PDFs or linked to a PDF library, which may be contravening several sort of legal laws. I'm kind of tempted to just do it anyway. So come on in, run at me. See what you're going to do. What are you going to do? Sue me for doing a project on malaria, which is sort of like one of the major Millennium Development Goals. I'm told by Oxford that that would be a foolish thing to do for my career. But anyway, it is tempting to do that. But it is a challenge. Now, of course, this is our currency. All these data are our currency. This is what we create our research protocols on our funding for. If we put it back out there, anyone could use it. So it's that balance. And I'm more inclined to think that we should be putting this stuff back out there. People should be able to repeat these experiments. People might be able to do something better than we can currently do. because they have much better computing capacity with Amazon Cloud or whatever, and they can run models in a completely different way. This will only improve the science if we make the data available. I'm just putting it out there as an alternative to open access publication. This is open access data. Should we, and it's a question for you all to consider, every time we publish something, also submit our data that goes with it, the raw data, for someone to reproduce it? This is what roadmap might look like when it goes online, a link to Google Earth and downloadable files, and that's it. Thank you very much.